everybody to my first ever lecture recital. The topic, as you can see, I will be speaking of Paavo Heinonen, the famous Finnish composer of contemporary music, from a clarinetist perspective, because I am a clarinetist. And we'll be looking at Discantus II, one of his earlier works. The goal of this lecture recital really is not only to familiarize you, although I'm sure many of you are familiar with this composer's music. I was not until I played this piece. So this is sort of an introduction of sorts to his style, to his type of writing. And hopefully my goal really is to sort of give you some listening tools that you can use in the future when you're listening to other contemporary composers, perhaps more music by this composer, perhaps solo pieces in general, because this piece is for clarinet solo, so no accompaniment. And a lot of times those pieces can be kind of difficult for audiences, especially audiences who maybe aren't familiar with contemporary music. So that is our matter today. So why this piece? Why this composer? For me, this project sort of serves as an introduction of sorts to my research topic for my proposed DocMus project. I am in my supernumerary year of the DocMus project, and my proposed project for the artistic study is a look at contemporary Finnish and American compositions for clarinet. When I say contemporary, my project is focusing on pieces that are all post-1980, so quite contemporary. And that leaves out quite a bit of development in the modern genre, right, if we start right at 1980. So the reason I picked this composer is because he is one of the most famous Finnish composers, and he also taught a lot of the composers who I would like to play in my DocMus project. So he taught people like Magnus Lindberg, Kaija Saariaho, you know, composers who we're all quite familiar with. And when you type his name into Wikipedia or wherever, you get these quotations like most significant living composer, most father of Finnish modernism, you know, these big kind of labels. So this guy's pretty important, right? Someone who we should study. In terms of how he defines himself as, he calls it a meta-modernist. And he views modernism, you know, we can define modernism in contemporary music a lot of different ways, but he views modernism as sort of a freedom to compose in many different ways. He wants to take influence from things that came before, but he's not interested in sort of any direct imitation. He's really not interested in copying, or so he's been classified as a big innovator. He's always doing new things. But from his perspective, at least based on what I've read, he's not doing it just to be new. He's doing it because he's constantly being inspired in a very organic way to take things he hears, things he's learned, and sort of use it as influence. And this affected his teaching a lot too. And knowing this about him, I think, can help us when we listen to his music, when we listen to his students. It will kind of resist any urge we might have to stick him in a box, or to stick one of his students in a box and say, they're trying to be serialist, or they're trying to be 12-tone, or any of these kind of labels we hear when we're talking about contemporary music. So we have the composer himself, obviously younger and slightly older. He's still alive, of course. So why this piece? Why did I choose this piece? This piece was the first one he ever wrote for clarinet. He wrote it in 1969. He was 31 years old, so kind of early in his career, but at a point where he kind of already established himself and begun experimenting in different ways of composing. This wasn't, you know, looking at a, you know, adolescent sketch. This was an established composer in one of the early pieces in his career. Now, looking at the title of the piece, Discountus 2, right, loaded title. 2 refers to the fact that it's the second of 3 discantuses, discanti, that he wrote. The first one was in 1965 for solo flute, the second one for clarinet in 1969, and the third one was actually for saxophone, and he wrote it in 1976. So that's where the 2 comes from. And now the discantus. Well, in Latin, discantus means singing apart. So it gives us a little clue, singing. And discant, as we might remember from our music history, refers to a style of liturgical setting from the Middle Ages. So already as a player, as a listener, we're thinking, okay, some of his influences, we got singing, we got liturgical setting, we got Middle Ages. Okay, interesting, interesting. And fortunately, we have some of his own notes he wrote about this piece. So he said, and I quote a translation, my translation, so pardon me. He said, in 1969, the situation in our music scene was such that it was desirable to look at other things than expressing and enhancing expression. Okay. So we know from him, and it's not uncommon in this time period from modern composers to have this view. And it was expressed already before him, Stravinsky, for instance, not aiming for expression in the same way that perhaps Schoenberg was, okay? He also has gone, Heinonen has been quoted as saying, music expresses nothing. Another kind of, okay, that's a serious statement, but it's important for us as players and as listeners because we approach it and we listen to playing it with slightly a different goal. We know he wasn't interested in expressing emotion, but he was interested in plurality. He was interested in sort of a lot of possibilities. He was very interested in sound, different types of sound. So I think it's, at least I know from a clarinetist perspective, when you write non espressivo on a piece of music, it's very, our inclination almost is to stop singing, right? And that's not the goal here. It's singing, but it's non-expressive. He also, looking again at his notes, he wrote that he turned to the liturgy for inspiration for this work, and this work explores the possibilities of polyphony in one line. So polyphony, as we know from our music history again, means multiple voices, multiple independent melodies at the same time, relating back originally to Middle Age religious music from the Middle Ages. And here, he uses polyphony in this work, which is very curious because you have a single voice, right? How can you, so it's very interesting. This is something we can listen for. What else? He talks about small musical poetics, as he looks at, small ideas, small, I won't say expressions, but small singing lines. He uses a lot in this work rest and repetition, so balanced, such that melodies grow and develop on each other, and then he gives you repetition and rest to sort of balance, let you digest what you've just heard, perhaps relate it to something you're going to hear again. We shall see. Finally, in this piece, so I wrote here a couple of key words for us to think about. We talked about different types of sounds, singing lines, polyphony, liturgy, you know, this idea of modern, what we expect to hear when we hear a modern piece versus sort of the ancient roots we know that he was sort of inspired by. The last point I will leave for a moment. So in this piece in general, we're to focus, and he writes this in his notes to the player, that the player should focus on depth of sound, lyrical language, a variety of different kinds of sounds, often even referencing other instruments, and we'll talk about that. And what he's not so concerned with is open versus virtuosity, experiments in form, and hidden polyphony. And what I think he means by that, and he was very, in what I read, I got the feeling that he was quite against sort of things being complicated for complicatedness sake, if that makes sense. He was very concerned with wanting the music to be understood by the player, to be understood by the audience. So this is my interpretation. This last note refers to the work is in three movements. Forgive me, I did not mention that at the start. Work is in three movements. They're actually meant to be played one after another, but for purposes of this lecture and this discussion, I'm gonna break them apart and we're gonna talk about each one. So the first movement and the third movement, he says in his notes, are very conventional. Second movement, contrast, jazz. We'll get there. So now, again, please scoot up if you cannot see. But for now, I would like to play for you the first movement. Please follow along. Actually, it's probably better. It's not so close. You can't follow along too closely.
Thank you.
Now, why do we do analysis besides for music theory homework? I think analysis is really important for two reasons. One, for the player. I think it forces us in a way, at least I found with this piece, that it forces the player to really take a look at what the composer's intentions were, how the piece was written. And there's a lot of, I believe, at least especially in contemporary music, there's a lot of different ways that we can analyze a piece. And I think it's important to find the way that works best for you. And I used a couple of tools, and then that leads me to the second reason I think analysis is important, is I also think it's really important for the listener. I think it's a useful tool that musicians can use, even to a listener who might not be a musician. I think alerting listeners to things like repetition, to stylistic influences, to quotations within a piece, even different tonal areas, I think can be really useful for a listener to understand the piece better. So, we talked about, in general, this piece, a couple of key words. Polyphony, right, was one. So, and hopefully you can see this a little bit, we did sort of one take on a polyphonic analysis. And it's funny, because when I did this analysis, and then, you know, I went on practicing the piece, and the more I play the piece, the more I'm like, oh, well, I don't know, maybe I can analyze it in this way. So it was a reminder to myself that there's a lot of different ways we can analyze the piece. But I kept with my original plan. So polyphony, right, multiple voices. So what I did was I kind of went through, and using these different colors here, I kind of tagged when I heard different things happening again. So, and you just heard it, but I'll sort of rise. So we have this figure at the beginning. Kind of defined as a second, I would say, from C sharp to C. And we can look later where this figure comes back again. It comes back in the third line. Is the most important notes of that two figure if you take the G flat and the F natural. Again, here. C sharp, C natural. So it comes back, so that's one voice, you could say. A motive would be another, but I'm going to use in this case a voice or a singing part because I think that was the composer's intention. He wrote, if we remember, that he's not interested in form, he's not interested in hidden polyphony. He wants everything. His goal, at least, I think, when he was writing the piece, is everything, there's no secrets. And so, moving on, we have another figure, this kind of yellow, which happens in the second line. And we can see that comes back. It's sort of this, I call it like the flowing eighth note singing line. there's no, we'll talk about tonality in a moment, but there's no tonal link. I'm not so concerned that the eighth note line gets repeated in the same with the same intervals every time, although many times it does. We have a lot of now looking this example, this example, this example. And that repeats itself. And so this is a way for the listener to, if the player knows these things, right, we can begin to emphasize certain things that hopefully the listener can pick up. And then for the listener, sort of, it can be sometimes very overwhelming to hear a piece like this. And when you see it, and you see it broken, broken up and you hear, I'm not sure how easy it was when you were hearing it for the first time, I guess for some of you it was the second time, to pick up on these repeated lines or to hear when these polyphonic lines switch. But sometimes to have the visual is helpful. So, does anyone have any questions about my take on a polyphonic analysis? Okay, so the other way, so this is one way we can look at the piece. Another way is tonality. So, in my good student research on this piece, I learned that the composer had two periods. He has two periods of composition as defined by somebody. His first period is dodecaphonic, 12 tone. His second period is serialist. And I said, okay. So I sat down and I started to do a 12 tone analysis. Didn't work. I was writing on the staff paper and I go, well, this note gets repeated. And, oh, well, it broke here. And so I started somewhere else. 12-tone analysis for this first movement, at least, didn't work, right? Now, that doesn't mean that we can't tonally analyze it in some loose sense. So, dodecaphony, meh, serialism, meh. But it is atonal, right? It is an atonal piece. We don't have our one-chord tonic chord and five-chord. It's atonal, and I think what he uses to sort of structure his atonality is a focus on some key pitches. So if we return to the score, for a moment, now we have a lot of pitches, right? But for me, some important ones, I mean, like when we're analyzing Mozart sonata, right? We always look at the first chord and the last chord. Oh, not always, but sometimes. I used to, anyway. So we look at the first note, C sharp, and the last note, G. Okay, to me, those were important notes in between. And so as I was playing it, when I got to C sharps, it formed a structural barrier for me. So the way I see this movement is it is atonal, but not in the structured way that I was expecting based on what I've read about this composer. Was a lesson to me. I'll say no more there. So, now, moving on to the second. I will say briefly that we talked about how the first movement, conventional, as the composer said, third movement, conventional. Second movement, he labeled as unconventional. He was influenced a little bit by jazz. We know he was interested in imitation of other sounds and instruments. So I will leave you with those small tidbits and I will play for you the second. And as you might have noticed, again, meant to play a taka without pause from the first movement, but for these purposes, not a taka. we see right away, unfortunately for the musician's point of view, much less rests, fewer rests, repetitions, but in a different way. It has more of a relenting feeling, an ongoing feeling, a little less restful than our polyphonic first movement. And we know he was a little bit interested in jazz. He was inspired by jazz improvisation, to be more specific. So as a classical clarinetist, how do I take that? Well, I, in my not jazz training, I noticed a couple things that to me sounded jazzy. So I marked a couple of them here, hopefully you can see. So first we have this opening figure, which repeats itself. Again, the idea of a melodic line building upon itself, developing upon itself, just like in the first movement. This time it's marked forte sforzando. And if I'm trying to imitate another instrument, I can think of a couple different things, right? Do I think of a violin scratching on a bow? Possibly. And hopefully that's not how it sounded, because that wasn't my intention. But that's not what I was thinking, right? He says, sempre legato, always smooth, long singing, but rhythmic and marcato. Legato, rhythmic, marcato. Ooh. Okay, so what I had in mind was sort of a jazz saxophone. That's what, in my mind, I was trying to think of. This sort of yada-da-da-da as a saxophone might play. Pardon, there are saxophones in the audience, but it's a little bit gestural, right? I have rhythm in a five tuplet. I have emphasis on the first note, so I'm trying to be rhythmical and singing and play throughout. And this is sort of a classical composer's way, drawing the player to sort of gestural motives, as we hear a lot in jazz. Second element, in the second line, notated with our yellow stripe there, is these offbeats or sondi, which we get a couple times. And that to me sounds a little bit jazzy too. Happens first in the first line, of course, but. Especially in the third line, when he marks to piano and then back again, it's sort of these wah, 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 a little bit jazzy, I think. In the fourth line, these repeated da, 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 da. Even though it's fortissimo, marcato, pretty high register, don't think it's intended in kind of a Strauss way or a Beethoven way. I mean, I think it's meant to be like a loud moment in, like, I think of like a jazz combo. Da 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 da. And then you have this glissando, which has been this is a extended technique that's sort of been incorporated into mainstream classical playing, but it's still not that common, and it's taken from jazz or Dixie or kind of the non classical idioms, these glissando, which I marked, for lack of a better, with a star. I use the star sort of as a generic marking to something meant to sound jazzy and not necessarily so classical in interpretation and in compositional goal. Jumping down now to the seventh line, we have the multiphonics, which happen a lot. It's the clarinet is meant to play one note at a time, and so in the contemporary repertoire in 20th century, you had composers sort of experimenting, well, what would happen if you sort of mess with the natural acoustic inclinations of the instrument and try to get two notes at once. So they're not, as you can see with the double sharps and the quarter tone, they're not meant to sound like chords because it's very, very difficult to get these to sound in tune. But when I was playing it, you know, you have this first opening building up to this really loud high B flat, and then you have these quarter tones, which I kind of viewed as sort of, again, forgive me for being stereotypical, but in jazz, sometimes you get these sort of like restful, quiet, clustery kind of chords, but it's like a tension release sort of thing within the piece. So you have this loud B flat, which I'll save your ears and not play again, but you have this really loud B flat you build up, and then you have something like. Imitation of other types of sounds. We already kind of referenced in the beginning wanting to sound like jazz, maybe a jazz saxophone. So I just pulled just a couple of examples of moments when I thought perhaps he was trying to imitate another instrument. So we spoke about the first one already. The second one, again, we spoke about the sforzandi gesture already, but what do we think that is supposed to sound like? Could be a trumpet with a mute. Could be a drum set hitting a rim shot and then rolling and crescendoing again. But not necessarily with a clarinet. Third, again another. Not so clarinet-y, again. Trombone maybe, right, with the glissando, possibly. I already spoke about sort of the tension release of the high B flat to the multiphonic, but also could be another instrumentation. You know, if we're thinking a big brass band or a jazz band, you know, hitting this loud chord and then settling on a mellower chord with piano. I think with multiphonics, it's easy kind of to imagine multiple players playing because that's what it's trying to imitate. And then finally, with these, repeated, we saw quite many, especially in the second page, these figures that gradually get faster, and then these repeat signs with a certain number of times of repeating. Again, kind of jazzy in sort of a riff kind of way, if you're supposed to settle on one bar and repeat it a couple times before moving on, not necessarily notation you see a lot in classical. To me, playing that as celerandoing and then landing on a multiphonic, it sounded kind of like a piano to me. It was sort of jazz piano, where you have this a single line, you know, and then settling on a chord. Again, these are just my interpretations, but my goal here is to sort of give you different ways of thinking about this piece and perhaps listening to it with a new set of ears. So we have a little bit of time left, and so what I'd like to do is play for you the final movement and sort of not necessarily discuss it, but my goal was for you to kind of apply the things that we've talked about for the last 40-odd minutes, 39 minutes to be exact. Think about those things we talked about and see if you can hear any of them. Again, this movement, the third movement, he labels conventional, like the first movement. So you can expect to hear more things in common with the first movement than with the second, but see what you hear. I would recommend sort of trying to listen for some polyphonic lines, try to see if anything, any of those lines we talked about from the first movement, if they come back or remind you. So, this is the third movement of Dismatches 2.
Thank you.
46 minutes. Does anybody have any questions or comments about alcohol at the last moment or anything else they talked about?
Where do you think that there is synergy? Or some kind of inspiration taken from liturgical stuff or?
Good question. For me, I am not religious, so I'm not very familiar in sort of the classical, but I found it in these simple lines, in I don't know that the lines themselves can be analyzed in sort of a modal, tonal way, but to me they sounded a bit modal. The idea of not a traditional center, the way the scales are built, the way, to be perfectly honest, what I thought of the most was simplicity. Simplicity of melodic lines, simplicity of singing lines, simplicity of singing style,
mm-hmm.
and gesture.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Did you, as you said in the opening, that the polyphony is a new phenomenon for you, it's almost, did you mean generally or just what you found so far? Because I mean, it's very familiar from 17th century.
Right.
Let's say for violin and cello and
that's
right.
Far. The clarinet was not invented,
yeah.
Of course, until the end, as we know. And so it is. Unfortunately, because the words just kind of flow, I'm having trouble remembering exactly when I said that or what I said. But in terms of polyphonic influence, yeah, I wasn't brought up playing the piano a lot, and the clarinet as a single voice instrument by ourselves, you don't play. And then the repertoire for the instrument, we're talking late classical to present day, so we don't get any sort of like the older church instruments. We don't get that kind of repertoire, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm.
It's about imitation. Well, you said about developing things, which is very close to imitation itself. Did you figure that?
I meant to actually two different things. So imitation. Referring to the composer's intent for the clarinet to kind of sound like another instrument, and then the melodic development being building on what came before to, I'm not sure if that answers your question.
Yeah, it does.
But
I think.
But I had intended sort of two different things, one with the development of the melodic line as it builds upon itself, which is one tool he uses quite prominently in this piece, and then imitation is sort of different gestures or different sounds meant to sound like another instrument. Sorry if that was unclear.
Thank you. So if I just make go on with the imitation thing, I mean, you could, since you mentioned liturgy, or the possession previously, so that perhaps you could think that some things might imitate liturgic ideas.
Yeah, for
idea
sure.
Idea of liturgic.
For sure. Yeah.
That's not very good kind of inspirational.
Yeah. And he wrote a lot of pieces for choir, he wrote a lot of pieces for church bells, he wrote especially quite later, and so to continue this analysis, one key would be perhaps looking at that repertoire and seeing, which came 15, 20, 30 years later, but seeing, he was writing, he branched out into sort of the weirder, if you can say, instrumentations later in his life, and was quite conventional in his instrumentations early on, as is could be said of any young composer. Takes time to sort of get the confidence and also financial support to branch out into more obscure things. But for sure, it would I would be very curious, because I'm not familiar with the liturgical repertoire that, say, an old string instrument or a singer might be. I'd be curious to either look at that, also to look at his later liturgical works to see what similarities might lie.
Perhaps other opinion of the Schlappen works.
I'm sorry?
In other works of
that's what I mean. Yeah, in his future, his most recent works, he wrote like a concerto for like four church bells or something. You know, stuff is kind of weird, but you can see in his future output that this sort of liturgical influence does play quite a big role as he continues his career.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
How about a very technical question about the note defines?
Yeah.
Why there are four notes? Most of the time I heard the fifth harmonic, which is the third, approximately major third above the fundamental.
Mm-hmm.
So what's the deal with that?
I can see that there's a fingering. There's a fingering, so I'll answer that in a couple ways. So the clarinet is, the multiphonic, as I said, is not a technique the clarinet was built to play. It's sort of something that's been developed later on. And the way, as you can see, unfortunately, I'm sorry, not so good for the fingerings, but a lot of times the multiphonic fingerings, as you can see, they involve like covering a bunch of holes and then leaving one open.
Mm-hmm.
Covering a bunch of holes and then leaving one open.
Mm-hmm.
That's typical because you have to break the acoustic column of the instrument.
So you create multiple resonance.
Exactly. But that being said, it's a very imprecise science. So
Are the notes, notated notes, like possibilities what you might get?
Sort of. Composers generally understand that, especially, I'm sure you probably noticed, bottom page of the second movement, down here, I'm quite troubled getting this to speak as I wished it, because multiphonics are very difficult to play loudly.
Yeah.
It's most easy to sort of slide into it, and then you can, the way you play it is the embouchure has to be perhaps a bit more relaxed and a bit more open in order to enable, get the flexibility you need to sort of get all those pitches. So in a nutshell, I hope that answers. It's sort of when you have the fingerings and then you see the chords and you get a lot of double sharps and things, it approximates.
Yeah.
It's a rough approximation of the type of sound. But again, most composers use it for an effect. In this case, you could sometimes hear the tonality in reference to the line that came before. So in that sense, it doesn't matter what multiphonic you play, but in terms of getting those exact pitches, it's a little bit, I didn't mention this at the beginning, I should have, because it's relevant to sort of the purpose of my study, but I am not, I don't consider myself like a solo. This repertoire is not my area of expertise, per se. I consider myself predominantly an orchestra musician. But what I am interested in terms of my proposed doctoral project, is the idea and argument that really all players, classical players, getting to be at the professional level should, even though this doesn't exactly relate to orchestral playing, we all should be playing this repertoire because it makes us think and play and make sounds and do technical things that sort of just increase our abilities and flexibilities and sensitivities and ears and all that.
I would ask about the interpretation.
Yeah.
How did you find it? Is it easy or is it somehow very difficult to get into this world of this texture?
For me, it's different pieces vary in difficultness. This piece was, I have to say, quite challenging. I thought when I went to learn a piece, of course, when we're learning it, my method anyway is you know, you play it through a lot,
mm-hmm.
and you get it on your fingers, and you kind of hope that your ear catches on to something that can help you,
mm-hmm.
sort of. And so it was a slow process with this piece, I have to say. And I don't, maybe you heard as a listener as well, there's certain things that you, and of course, it's my job to make it easy for you to interpret, but even when you're listening, you might have heard some things that are easy sort of to, not easy, but easy to relate to, or you
mm-hmm.
hear things that are intriguing to your ear, and you hear other
mm-hmm.
things that are kind of confusing.
Mm-hmm.
I think especially with the third movement, it was perhaps the most challenging for me because it's quite long,
mm-hmm.
And it's fragmented in a way, a
mm-hmm.
bit more than the first and the second.
Yes, I know I find him much more emotional, even
mm-hmm.
He's a kind of a romantic composer nowadays.
Right, which
but this time, he said that it's not about emotions here.
Right.
But what do you think? Could it be something like saying something? Or
I also firmly adhere to this, is just because an author, a composer might say, I don't intend for you to feel X, Y, or Z, it doesn't mean the audience can't and that's wrong. Or it doesn't mean that, you know, sometimes the composer intention can be useful for some things, and then,
yeah.
you know, if the audience hears something else, then
mm-hmm.
that's, they feel something, that's great, you know. But yeah, I read a couple of commentaries about him, and a couple of writers had said that he sort of became more commercial at some point, that was there, which you can sort of read this, you get this a lot in contemporary music and in modern music, because there's so many different subgenres and so many different approaches and so many people who think a different way than other people. And so who's to say? His most recent interviews,
mm-hmm.
he still considers himself an individualist. He still considers himself this meta-modern term that I referenced at the beginning, that was from an interview of like a year or two ago. I mean, I feel like if you asked him, he might view himself in the same, kind of in the same vein, developing with the same ideals
mm-hmm.
and mentality, but of course that doesn't mean that the music is going to sound the same that it did when he was 31.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'm always getting hooked with this. If there is a composer who says, his aim is not to communicate with people, or there is no intention of
mm-hmm.
Emotions are not the only way to communicate, for sure,
exactly.
But still, I even took 2 years lessons from a modern classical composer in order to find
mm-hmm.
what is the, because my goals for composing something are quite the opposite,
mm-hmm.
always. They always start from the intention of having a feeling and trying to transfer that feeling into the song, and then...
Yes, that's one way, but there are other ways.
Yes, yes, and I realized also that they are not so interested in the performance also, because the idea, yeah, but at least for the teacher I had, his opinion was clearly that the composition is very close to a mathematics equation. So it's perfect when it's on the paper, when it's there as an, let's say, a Plato kind of,
mm-hmm.
in the idea world.
There are many composers who have that.
Yeah.
And then,
but not him.
Okay.
No, I know. No, this composer.
I don't know him, and this doesn't sound like that totally.
No, and it's interesting because his students span a wide, and I would say that not all, certainly, but a great. great majority of the students think somewhat in his way.
Yeah.
Not all of them, because he taught.
In his way,
in the idea of not being so
narrative?
No, just you know, the idea of serialism, if we think of the Milton Babbitt sort of way, where it's very systematic, and this idea of the composition being this math, sort of mathematical,
mm-hmm.
this set system, and the player interpretation. There is a great deal of contemporary music like that,
mm-hmm.
but this, and also in many ways, the goal of my own proposed doctoral project is to sort of look at the other. I don't want to call them audience friendly. I don't want to use that term, but I think
because the other one would be audience hostile.